supply is one of the challenges that at least the industry are going to wrestle with. Economic drag. We can debate how much of the economy we should spend on healthcare, but one thing we cannot debate that's an absolute truth is that if we can get the same or better healthcare for less money, we will free up enormous resources to flow into other more productive industries. Part of the reason the average person in this country has not had a wage increase in over 20 years is that an ever-increasing percentage of their compensation package has had to pay for healthcare. If we can figure out, we in this room and throughout the industry, if we can figure out how to provide the same or better healthcare for less money, I want to emphasize this, we will free up enormous resources for more productive activities, including paying people more take-home pay. Fragmented and brittle. Everyone knows the healthcare system is fragmented. By definition, fragmented systems break more easily and more catastrophically. And how do we break in healthcare in the U.S.? We break when we have unnecessary deaths. We break when people go bankrupt. Healthcare is the leading form or the leading cause of bankruptcy. We break when people don't have access to vital care. We break when we don't provide the frontline services to keep people from needing care. It drives me crazy. It just drives me crazy that there's enough money in the system to amputate a foot, but no money in the system to provide the chronic care management to prevent the amputation. It drives me crazy. So, you know, if that's not enough of an indictment, those four things, I think what's worse is this empathy gap. Healthcare system doesn't think about the patients, despite all the language of putting patients first. It's mostly about generating revenue. And I have a slide a little later on where I'll go into a little bit more depth. But I do believe ultimately the organizations that are going to win are those that do truly align with patients. It's not about making life easier for doctors. It's not about being physician-centric. It's not about just being bigger. It's about being better and delivering for patients. And you ought to take that every day and kind of remind yourselves as you're going about to work, what are we doing to make life better for patients? Because today in America, I bet you all have your own individual stories of what it's like to navigate the health system, but we don't do justice to our people. So, I pulled this from a health affairs article from 4 or 5 years ago, and they were separate graphs, but I superimposed them on each other. So the jagged blue line looks at mortality, and how many people died in the hospital. And you can see in the early 1800s, it was a lot, and it was pretty random, went up and down. And then as medicine improved, we're now down to very low mortality rates. About 2% of the people in our hospitals die. It's consistent. The other is the average cost for each alive discharge. And again, this is Mass General Hospital. And it's adjusted for money, so these are all today's dollars. And you can see that the average discharge up until the mid-60s was probably in and around $1,000, $500 to $1,000 adjusted for time. What happened in the mid-60s? Medicare, Medicaid. So we faced this inflection point, and the numbers just started going north. And I believe there are two original sins baked into the original enabling legislation for Medicare. And President Johnson had to agree to these two things to get Medicare passed. The first was cost plus reimbursement. You know, terminology today is fee for service, but basically having to pay for activity. AMA required that. And then the second was no medical interference or no governmental interference in medical decision making. That's a pretty wide standard. So as long as a doctor can justify a treatment, government has to pay for it, and by extension, commercial. So it just took off. There was an health policy economist, Milton Romer from UCLA, who at the time looked at this and said, made this statement, In the presence of third-party reimbursement, supply creates its own demand. That's another way of saying that if you build, you know, a hospital bed built is a hospital bed filled. So this whole concept of supply-driven demand is why we have operating rooms that only run one shift a day, 4 days a week, and they pay for themselves. The supply creates its own demand. If you were to go around this country and try to predict how many cardiology procedures would occur in any market in the country, you wouldn't look at demographics. You wouldn't look at lifestyle. You wouldn't look at some of the environmental factors that could be driving that. What you do is you look at the number of cardiologists in that market. They literally create their own demand. So that when I say artificial economics, that's what I'm referring to. And so let me try and put this in context of, again, the centralized system versus top-down versus bottom-up. And I'm going to do it. I'm a little addicted to these great courses programs where you can listen to professors talk about lectures. I happened to be driving through Indiana several years ago listening to a lecture on the Austrian School of Economics. Friedrich Hayek, for those of you who know that name, was a Nobel Prize winner who taught at the University of Chicago. And he was a big advocate of free market capitalism and democracy. And there was a very active debate after World War II about whether a planned economy or a capitalist economy could deliver better results. And we sit here today, you know, 70 years later, and say, well, of course, capitalism was the right answer. But it's a little more complicated than that. First, we did not spend, we spent 2% of our economy on government spending prior to the Great Depression, and today it's a little over 20%, and a lot of that cushions the extremes of capitalism, things like unemployment insurance. Also, at that time, the early 40s, or mid-40s, Europe was in ruins, the memories of the Great Depression were still fresh in everyone's mind, and you could even make the statement, and I've heard people do this, that fascism and communism were political reactions to unbridled capitalism. So the idea that you couldn't do a better job planning it than letting market unbridled market forces go loose was actually a pretty vigorous debate. So into this debate rode Friedrich Hayek, and he often talked about the price of tin increasing. And in a capitalist system, you're all going to know this is second nature. Price goes up, contains meaningful information, manufacturers adjust, essential users find substitutes for processes, or manufacturers find processes. Some raise their prices, but pretty soon you get back to equilibrium. In a planned economy, you need an army of central planners first to figure out why did the price of tin go up, what are the uses of tin, what are the priorities of those uses, what prices should we assign to those, and then how do we enforce that the marketplace honors those. Before long it's really complicated and easy to make mistakes. You end up with too many tin cups and not enough tin pans. Anyway, I'm listening to this and I'm going, holy cow, that's Medicare. Right? You've got an army of people in Baltimore figuring out how to pay for healthcare services using these very complex formularies, and it gets really complicated and easy to make mistakes. And by this point, I was driving into Indianapolis, which was at that time building four brand new cardiac surgery centers at a time when the incidence of cardiac disease was actually decreasing. So there we go. So you end up with this fuzzy math in healthcare, where revenues are flexible, expenses are less important because they're baked into reimbursement formulas, and the difference is margin. And we actually have the worst of all worlds. So in those centralized systems, like I talked about, you've got centralized pricing like we do with Medicare, but then you've also got a global budget, so they keep one another in check. In the US, we have exactly the worst of all situations. We have centralized pricing, and then we have ferocious private market exploitation of these incentives built into the centralized pricing. That's why revenue cycle is such an important function in hospitals. And by the way, this is a marketing group. If you don't know what revenue cycle is, I can tell you at every hospital inside of Advocate, as a neon sign that flashes optimized revenues, and lots of decisions get made there. And by necessity, they have to, because that's what keeps the engine going. But we're in the very early stages of shifting from this supply-driven demand, revenue-based system to one that is going to be more focused on value and really delivering for customers. And in that sense, optimizing revenue is not the goal. Creating value is the goal, and that's really the genius of the American economic system. I've been talking long, so I'm just going to touch on this. Hubert Humphrey had a quote: "The true test of government is how it treats those at the beginning of life, the end of life, and the margins of life." And I paraphrased it here, but just among yourself, just think about how we treat people at the beginning of life when we still don't allow most mothers to carry to term for births, when we are so ineffective at end-of-life care, and when we exclude people that need vital behavioral health or other types of preventive care from the system. You know, how well are we living up to this challenge? So why is this time different? If you look at the government is really pushing payment reform. Everything in the last 3 years, I see some hands waving. Just maybe I should do a time check, Megan. I'm thinking I've got about 15 minutes left. Is that okay? If I need to go faster, I will. Everything the government is doing is trying to shift us toward different payment mechanisms, bundled payments. The new macro legislation, how we pay doctors, it's got embedded in it. In order to pay primary care doctors more, providers need to do less, kind of forcing this supply-driven demand question. Accountable care organizations. All of that is trying to nudge the system in the direction of providing greater value. Corporations, including Advocate, for a long time just kind of went along. They had an HR budget, and they funded a certain amount of it, and as healthcare went up, they shifted more and more of the cost to employees. But now, now corporations are getting more active. Boeing in Seattle is bidding off the care for its workforce between Providence Health and Services and the University of Washington. And those two companies, both of which I know well, believe they not only have to deliver on the quality and the performance and the customer experience metrics, they also need to reduce Boeing's cost by about 25%. So that's not CPI plus one, that's CPI minus. So the only way to do that is to cut out unnecessary care and do a better job of preventative care. So that's happening. Consumers, because of high deductible health plans, more information, are becoming more active in purchasing decisions. And as I mentioned earlier, there's enormous amounts of smart money flowing into healthcare services and provider-based services. So part of the reason you should feel great about working for Advocate is Advocate isn't sitting on the sidelines as these major changes are coming through the society. They're out fighting for the industry right now on the ability for a health system to become a fully integrated system and offer insurance plans. I did an op-ed piece last summer, and Advocate loves me for this, because the title was, "Hey FTC, you're chasing the wrong 900-pound gorilla in Chicago." And it's true. The fact that the FTC is upset that prices in one zip code on the North Shore could be distorted by the Advocate North Shore merger is the craziest thing I've ever heard. Particularly when Blue Cross Blue Shield controls 75% of the marketplace. Who do you think exercises more power? And what that's really about is Blue Cross really trying to maintain its dominant position. And what they're really afraid of is that Advocate and North Shore together will actually figure out how to be an effective competitor. So you've got a company that has spent the last 15 years trying to figure out how to organize physicians more effectively. Tough to do. I mean, independent physicians, they have that word independent in front of their title for a reason. But very tough to do. They've worked through the governance issues, very advanced on standardizing care and protocols, and now trying to make these next steps into integrated delivery. And the biggest deficiency in the system is care management, the ability to care effectively for distinct population groups. But it's also the biggest business opportunity. Part of the reason that, and it's funny, you know, Advocate's partner in integrated delivery was Blue Cross. You've got that massive program with 300,000 people in it. And it's been tough to get the facilities and the care right, because the better job you do with care management, that means less healthcare you can provide in your facilities. So while you're doing a better job of care management, it also means right-sizing the facilities and services. So this time is different. And here's the emerging reality, is, and I did a 2x2 matrix here. The x-axis is care duration, so episodic to ongoing, and the y-axis is care uncertainty, low to high. And when you put those four in, you end up with commodity care, specialty care, complex care, and chronic care. Let's talk a bit about commodity care, because it's the most important. When an outcome is virtually certain to be positive, when you're sure that the outcome is going to be positive, definition of quality shifts to price, customer experience, and convenience. Let me say that again. It shifts from whether or not you're going to have a positive outcome to price, customer experience, and convenience. It's essentially a retail system. How many of you have seen this new company, the billboards in Chicago, called Smart Choice MRI? Mm-hmm. Yeah. An MRI shouldn't cost an arm and a leg, the cure for the $2,600 MRI. That is the future we're talking about. So anything that has a positive outcome and can be commodified, and that's going to become, that you're going to need, as a company, you need to figure out, well, how do we live with $600 MRIs rather than $2,600 MRIs, and apply that to the vast majority of services that occur, because 70-75% of healthcare probably fits into this commodity care bucket, and it's coming down. So knee replacements, hip replacements used to be high-end specialty care, but increasingly those are becoming routine, and if they haven't already become commodity care, they will shortly. So everything's coming down. You're starting to see in the specialty care the emergence of these focused factories, a little bit like I described in India, that can do high volume orthopedic, cardiology, even oncology care at a fraction of the cost, partly because they run the facilities harder. So there's going to be specialty care combination in that way. And we're still going to need places to do complex care, the really tough cases, the comorbidities, the solution shop. But the question is, how many of those types of organizations are we going to need in any given market? We have six healthcare companies in Chicago that do transplants, heart transplants. Should we really even have more than one? Lots of expense there. And then the chronic care side, as I said, that's becoming increasingly important too, the care management function. And so as companies get better at that, there'll be less need for the other three buckets. So this is the emerging reality. And I think what happens in health systems is they tend to try to be all things to all people, and they smash these together, but they're fundamentally different businesses. So commodity healthcare is a retail business, high margin or high volume, low margin business. Different supply chain, different business model, different way of interacting with customers. You gotta be able to compete there. Specialty care, that again is kind of this focused factory model. The chronic care is care management. It's really getting individuals to work with you in communities and trust you with their care, share their information. I think when you look at Advocate, you're really in all of these businesses, and you're figuring, I know the senior team pretty well, and they're trying to figure out, okay, how do we compete effectively in these? So when you have your insurance company, you're going to be in a lot of that chronic care management. But then you're also, because you own the risk, are going to be trying to figure out, how do we prevent care with better front-end primary and preventive care? And if we do, if someone does need acute care intervention, how do we do that in the best way? How do we get them second opinions? How do we give them care navigation? So that's where we're going to go. In the world of the future, the companies that survive, as I said, are going to be the ones who align with patients, but they're also going to be the ones who know what they're really good at and figure out how to do it even better every day. So I sometimes call this Amazoning healthcare. And what Amazon did to the publishing business is just brutal. They realized that at the end of the day, all you need in publishing is a writer and a reader, and they can take care of everything in the middle. Well, the corollary in healthcare is on one end you got caregivers, and at the other end you got patients, and then the organizing stuff in the middle can be marginalized or reduced. The pharmacy industry is ripe for this type of overhaul. Everybody remembers the EpiPen from last summer, right? The price of an EpiPen was $610. Mylan, the manufacturer, only got $230 of that $610. The rest went to the pharmacy benefit companies, the insurance company, and the retail pharmacies. And nobody knows exactly how much. It's very opaque. But when you get the kind of clarity where you've got, a drug and a patient and a doctor and a patient, there will be transparency on is it effective, how much should it cost, and so on. And those intermediate functions get disintermediated. That's where the term comes from. So markets bend toward value. This is a great quote from Bill Gates, that we always overestimate the change that will occur in the next 2 years and underestimate the change that will occur in the next 10, so don't be lulled into inaction. So we've got the disruptors out there. I've mentioned some of the focus factories, the enhanced primary care, the retail, big retail clinics. I mean, if you don't think CVS and Walgreens and Walmart are going to be involved in chronic disease management in 10 years, I don't know what you're smoking. And then these asset-light providers like DuPage Medical out here. DuPage Medical has an ambulatory surgery center. They do 20,000 procedures at that center. Typical ambulatory center does 7,500. Just think of their per unit cost advantage. They also have created these breakthrough centers to manage the most sick of the Medicare population. And 90 plus percent can be of what happens can be treated there. So if someone presents at one of your ERs, someone, if it's not imminent, or they don't need imminent treatment, someone from DuPage Medical's breakthrough center will come and make sure that the person shouldn't get, needs to get admitted into the ER, and most of the time they bring them back to the breakthrough center. So the disruptors are out there. And at the end of the day, you need both technology and humans. I call this DAM, decisions almost made by machines. Let me give you an example of, I'll skip through that, what Uberizing healthcare or Amazoning healthcare looks like. So this is a company here in Chicago that's combining Expedia with medical tourism, curated, customized, transparent, easy, and expensive. And so you can go online and you can pick your provider and your date, get your travel costs. And by the way, if your insurance pays for it, and they can deliver it for yes, often they can deliver a check to the patient for that difference. Wow, right? So this is the world we're on the cusp of, and the question is, for companies like Advocate, actually all in health, is how do you play in this world? And these are the new value rules. I've got five of them. Quality is job one. As I said, in most organizations, generating revenue is job one. But honestly, if quality isn't job one, then you're not going to be as good at it as you should be. I know Advocate puts quality as top of the chart, but all organizations can do better. Treating entire care episodes, not treatment codes, price matters, getting the data right, the human interaction, interface right. Probably most importantly, it's the customer stupid. So all companies have inputs and outputs. In the middle, how you organize those is what's really essential. And the things that ultimately are going to differentiate organizations are the brand, your prices, and the customer experience. It's why what you do in this room is so important. You are the carriers of the advocate brand out into the marketplace. So figuring out what you're good at, putting patients first, delivering best outcomes at lowest prices, that's what winning is going to be like in post-reform healthcare. And John Powers was one of the first great marketing minds in the United States. He was marketing for Wanamaker's department store, and he drove Wanamaker crazy. They were the first ones to put price tags on items. Mm-hmm. But he had three rules, he said, the commandments. He said, you gotta be interesting, you gotta speak the truth, and you gotta live the truth. And if you can't live the truth, then change what you're doing so you can. And I think human beings as a whole have gotten very good at figuring out when an organization is telling the truth or not telling the truth. And as we evolve in market-based reform, that trust, that customer-patient relationship is going to be absolutely essential. And the companies that really honor that will be the winners. So this is my last slide. There's an adage that says, fish never discover water, because they're swimming in it all the time. So this is the fee-for-service healthcare volume world there on the left. It's crowded, you know, water's getting murky, it's hard to swim around, and there's this great value world on the right that has all kind of promise, but you've got to be able to jump out of the hole and get there. So I think it's a false choice, this idea that you got to choose either to be a volume player or a value player. You've got to be a value player. Health systems have historically been defensive. You need to go on the offensive. You need to differentiate, and you need to win the right way by putting patients first, delivering better care at lower costs, making it more convenient, and really trying to be part of that federation I talked about at the earlier part of the day, deliver for society. Give us what we all want, better health care, more affordable health care, more convenient health care, more compassionate health care. So thanks very much.